This is iOS 18. It's stunning and quite possibly the biggest change to the iPhone user experience since the iPhone X, which was the biggest leap hardware-wise and introduced the new swipe gestures in place of the home button. But if you think about it, software-wise, iOS has looked the exact same since iOS 7, which transitioned from skeuomorphism to a cleaner, more sophisticated, minimalist look. iOS 18 aims to change this, and the best part is all iPhones from 2018 and up are supported, which means the last beautiful iPhone, the XS, and the latest abomination, the 16 Pro, will all run the same software. Well, at least until Apple Intelligence launches. The most recognizable change is home screen and app icon customization. In previous versions of iOS, the lock screen and home screen wallpapers had to be different. The only way to maintain continuity of the lock screen wallpaper was to blur the image. But as you can see, now there's an option to remove the blur, and as a result, the unlocking experience is much more seamless. To customize the icons, one has to hold down anywhere on the home screen, select Edit, then choose Customize. This brings up a small menu which allows one to choose between small and large icons, a light or dark home screen, and also between light and dark icons, or automatic, which changes with the operation of dark mode. Tapping the tinted icon brings up two color bars, and using the drop tool, one can match the icons to any color on your wallpaper. Then precisely adjust the amount of color saturation the app icons should have, either completely white or more rich. On iPhone XS, the oldest supported iPhone for iOS 18, adjusting these features is still pretty smooth, with only a moment's worth of lag noticeable while applying a new color to the app icons. Speaking of app icons, it's now possible to place them anywhere on the screen, but of course only within the grid. So if you have a person, car, or object in your wallpaper, the apps can be tailored to fit around them rather than blocking them in. Next up is button animations. When pressing a button, the bezel appears to extend into the screen a tiny bit. Combined with the dynamic island, it portrays that on iPhone, even dead space is given high importance. Then we have the new touch control. Apple is diving head-on into the dynamic island features, evident by the touch control animation, which springs out from the dynamic island. And for the first time on any smartphone, this enables precision brightness control and changing of the focal point. Furthermore, the LEDs fade in and fade out, which is certainly a nod to luxury car DRLs or parking lights, which do the same. At first, Instagram Reels, which mocked this feature, tricked me into believing that this was a gimmick. But honestly, it's not. For example, if you want a better close-up field of view at night, the diffuse mode lights up objects very well at a close range. And similar to the high beams on a car headlight, the max mode creates a hotspot right in the center, thus lighting walls and objects extremely well even if they are 3 to 5 meters away. However, there's a caveat with pretty huge ramifications. The new brightness slider is only available on iPhones with the dynamic island, and only the Pro versions 14 Pro and up have the hardware to change the focal point, whereas the regular iPhones, the 15 and 16, only have the brightness adjustment. Even lower on the tier is the notched iPhones like the XS Max. One still has to swipe down from the top right corner of the screen to open the control panel, and only then can the brightness of the torch be adjusted. And it's only limited to 4 to 5 levels, which was the same as in iOS 17. As can be seen on Apple's Compare iPhone webpage, all models with a notched display have True Tone flash with slow sync, which does not support the new torch slider control. This includes models from the XS series up to the 13 Pro series. The calculator app also sees improvements, with a new notes feature, built-in graphic display, and on-device unit conversion. There's also the ability to delete digits. To change the mode, press the calculator icon on the bottom left. This basic scientific maths notes and an on-off toggle for the conversion feature. In notes mode, pressing the icon on the bottom right starts a new note. Then selecting the pen slash marker tool allows one to start writing equations by hand. And for the first time ever on an iPhone, I feel like a stylus would be a great addition.
Who wants a stylus? You have to get them and put them away and you lose them. Yuck. Nobody wants a stylus.
To kickstart the auto-calculate feature, add an equals to sign at the end of an equation, and the phone automatically recognizes the handwriting, converts it into numbers, solves the equation, and then gives the answer all in the same handwriting in real time. And here's where it gets even more revolutionary. It is now possible to churn out graphs as seen on Apple's support page for graphs in Math Notes. As someone who has used graphic display calculators for high school maths, physics and chemistry, it means a lot. The most popular GDCs were Texas Instruments Inspire series, and these are huge, chonky devices and are not designed for notes due to their ABCD keyboard layout. They also aren't water resistant, even a light drizzle can cause damage, have obsolete charging ports, and the displays aren't visible under direct sunlight. Having a graph display capability in the native calculator app and not needing to buy a whole separate calculator is a huge win. To insert a graph, all one needs to do is type or paste an equation with two or more variables, for which a small insert graph option pops up. Pressing on the aforementioned brings up the graph window, which can be resized like so, and the color of the graph can be selected from a color grid, color spectrum, or using the sliders. The opacity can also be modified as desired. The unit converter can be set to angle, area, currency, data, energy, force, fuel, length, power, pressure, speed, temperature, and much more. So you can easily calculate that 100 kilometers an hour is 62.13 football fields per hour, 100 degrees Celsius is 212 V8 revs, and 100 eagle screeches is 8,345 rupees. The best part about the new calculator is, even on the XS Max, which is using 7-year-old hardware, most of the functions, including the handwriting recognition feature, work flawlessly and with zero lag. It's not all positive though, because the calculator is incredibly finicky with how an equation is typed, and occasionally refuses to grant the option to display a graph. The camera app has received a major overhaul, which enables pausing a video recording for the first time ever on iPhone. More impressive is the ability to add slow motion to a 4K video even post-recording it. To make use of this feature, first select 4K 60fps or 4K 120fps if you have the 16 Pro. Then one can turn the flash on, start the first part of the video recording, then pause it, change the scene, turn off the flash, and record a fast-moving object to slow down in post. Add some B-roll to give context to the scene, turn the flash on again to get a close-up shot of the subject, then finally a motion shot which transitions into a full shot of the subject. To edit the video, open the Photos or Camera app, then tap on the video edit slider, which brings up a speedometer on the top right of the screen. There will be an option to reduce the frame rate by half, which will be based on your exposure settings. This lets you add a 50% playback speed to the section of the video, which you can modify by using the slow-mo slider on the video timeline. I have added a 0.5x playback speed to the clip of the spinning disc player. As can be observed, these settings are applied in real time and rendered in real time as well, making for a seamless experience. Here's a short 4K 60 clip taken on an iPhone 15 with zero editing to demonstrate how one may utilize the pause video recording feature. It may not be a direct replacement for cutting and stitching clips using an editing software, but it definitely reduces the number of video files to be transferred during editing. The Photos app also has a new light theme layout, which is tied to the overall system display settings for light and dark mode. This makes it much easier to edit a photo or video outdoors, even under harsh sunlight. And at night, dark mode makes it easier on the eyes. However, if you like me prefer the dark mode for the photos viewer and editor, turning off light mode is an absolute faff. You first need to select edit photo or video, then click on the three dots on the top right of the screen. Then click appearance, and only then can you choose between system, dark, or light. And now when playing back video, the thumbnail doesn't expand into the timeline control, but rather there is a separate timeline right above the video, which makes it much easier to select other photos or videos after scrubbing through a video. Moving on to slow motion recording, iOS 18 also enables adjustable slow motion speed / frame rate for the first time ever on iPhone, with a new super slow 0.1x playback speed at 24fps, or if one prefers a smoother video, they can select a 0.25x playback speed at a high 60fps frame rate. This feature is a boon because slowing down a video in post using Final Cut Pro or any other software takes quite a bit longer, and it generates new filler frames to smoothen the slow motion effect. However, it is not quite on the level of simply reducing the frame rate of a video file natively. But there's a problem. Adding slow motion to a video shot on an older iPhone is borderline unusable, with the iPhone XS stuttering while adjusting the start and end of a slow motion section and taking forever to prepare the video. Can you keep a secret? Well, at least now your iPhone can, with the ability to lock or hide apps. To hide any application, long press on the app icon. At the bottom of the menu which pops up is Require Face ID. Tap on it and then select Hide and Require Face ID. This will remove the app from the homepage and even hide it from the search function. The only way to access the app will be at the bottom of the app drawer in a folder titled Hidden, so anyone you give your phone to now knows you're hiding something from them. To unhide the app, follow the same steps. Then click either Don't Require Face ID or Unhide App. This returns the app back to the homepage. Meanwhile, selecting the Require Face ID option keeps the app in the same location, but now runs Face ID authentication on each launch. The lock screen controls can be swapped out now. To do so, long press on the lock screen, then select Lock Screen Customization. Remove the standard lock screen buttons, then press the plus icon. One can choose between launching apps, dark mode, many capture options, clock, connectivity, and more. For example, if you post to Instagram and scan barcodes for a menu or payment alert, it is possible to put an Instagram camera capture button and a barcode scan button right on the lock screen. This can save a lot of time, and you can disable library access for Instagram while still being able to capture a moment in a short time. The barcode scanner also has a built-in torch control, which makes it better than using the standard camera app in low light conditions. Interestingly, there is no fade in or out LED animation here. The custom lock screen buttons was certainly made with the new iPhone 16s in mind, whose camera button and action button make the traditional quick access camera and torch buttons redundant. Now time for the control center. You can now rearrange apps and resize your controls. Customize how your controls are laid out, resize them, or build your own groups of controls. Fun fact, there's a new power off button on the top right of control center. Does this foretell a no physical button iPhone or a no button iPhone at all? Who knows? To resize icons, press the plus sign on the top left corner and simply choose the icon you wish to enlarge and change the position of. On the default control center page, this is easy to do. However, for LawTech Pro knows what reason, Apple has replaced the space usually taken up by the mobile data on and off button with one which turns on and off AirDrop, which is downright stupid because my AirDrop is always set to contacts only. And the only time I use AirDrop is to transfer files from my iPhone to my Mac. So now to turn mobile data on or off, one needs to open the connectivity folder, then click on mobile data, or scroll all the way down to the third page of the control center, then do the same. There is a wide array of buttons to add to the control center, such as capture, clock, connectivity, display, brightness, focus, home, notes, music, translate, utilities, and many more. But observe what happens when I go to add any of these and adjust their position. It's an absolute nightmare. Unlike the home screen app icons, there is no real-time positioning of the control center icons displayed, and they just vanish into thin air and reappear in random places, which means getting that perfect orientation of controls is near impossible. Thankfully, the new battery limit and information page makes up for it. As seen in iOS 17, the battery cycle count and the manufacturer use/date are displayed. But now there's a new page titled Charging. This holds a battery charging limit slider, which is set to 95% by default. You can set it back to 100% by selecting Set Limit to 100%. Or you can select any range between 95% and 85% to preserve battery health. And this turns off optimized battery charging since the phone no longer charges to 100%. As always, there's a bummer. This new limit is only available on iPhones released in 2023 or newer. So even though the 14 Pro uses the same A16 Bionic chip with 6GB of RAM like the 15 Plus, it does not get the ability to set a charge limit, just the same old optimized battery charging. This is a shame because the limit is just a software limit, since optimized battery charging anyway does the exact same thing. But instead of choosing a limit between 85% and 95%, it just sets the limit at 80%. Now onto the big DAGs, starting with iPhone mirroring on macOS, Toyota Sequoia. Provided your devices are connected to the same iCloud account, all one needs to do is turn on Wi-Fi and lock their iPhone. Then click on the iPhone mirroring icon on the dock. It opens up to a quick start guide, then asks you to unlock your iPhone. Just enter your password, decide to allow or not allow notifications, and iPhone mirroring is ready to use. It shows this cool boot up animation and starts mirroring your iPhone without any hesitation. You only need to set this up once. The next time you start mirroring, it starts right up with no agreement pop-ups whatsoever. And the latency is extremely low, so you can play games in landscape orientation and drag the window to wherever you want to on your MacBook screen, but it cannot be resized. The touchpad functions as a regular pointer and click-based system and does not duplicate the iPhone screen. So in-game functions like drifting by holding the left corner of the trackpad and deploying nitros by tapping the right corner does not work. You need to click on the icon itself once, and then whenever you click on the trackpad, it replicates a click on the same part of the iPhone screen. You can also use it to run Instagram, since the desktop version of Instagram sucks. And here full functionality is available, which includes viewing, liking and commenting on posts, and also watching Instagram Reels. Click on the white bar to go home, and a click on the top right of the window brings up the app switcher, and most apps here work, save for the camera app, as the phone is technically turned off. The iPhone mirror window behaves like any other app window and can be moved across desktops. Currently, it's not possible to drag images from the window onto things like documents, but a future update will bring this handoff/continuity feature to iOS 18 and Toyota Sequoia. In fact, here's a clip from 9to5 Mac, which demonstrates the drag and drop feature working mind-numbingly well on an iOS 18.1 beta. To access hidden apps, simply swipe to the left to bring up the app drawer. Click on the hidden folder and authenticate the request using Touch ID on your Mac. And now the hidden app can be opened. Great success! To close an application, simply open the app switcher, then do a full swipe up to close one or all of the applications. To end a session, simply close the window. After a session is closed, a privacy warning appears on iPhone saying iPhone was used from a Mac. To revoke permission, open settings, head to general and then to AirPlay and continuity. From here, you can forget the Mac, which is used to mirror your iPhone, and toggle on or off handoff plus continuity. The final boss of iOS 18 features is the remote control on FaceTime, which allows you to take control over your parents' phone. So now, instead of waiting till you get home to answer their IT queries, just FaceTime them. First, tap on the share icon, then click on Ask to Share. After this, a pop-up will appear on their end. Ask them to click Share, and now you will see their screen in a small window. Click on that window, and on the bottom right will be a finger pointing at something. Click on that, then ask your parent to allow control over their phone. Once that is complete, you can now operate their phone as usual. Minimize the FaceTime window like so, moving it off to the side, and then proceed to solve their problem. In this case, I need to enable the always-on display. So I'll open settings, search for always-on display, and then turn it on, like so. Though these phones are side by side, they are connected to the internet through cellular data on a mostly stable 5G network. Though for some reason, the iPhone 14 Pro says that it's on 4G. And therefore, it does lag quite a bit, as visible when I apply these customizations to the app icons. So then, I will proceed to change the wallpaper on the 14 Pro using my other iPhone. There are many new wallpapers available in iOS 18, but this is one of my favorites, as it gradually transitions from completely color-filled flowers on the lock screen to only the outer edges being visible in the always-on display mode. Just lovely wallpaper. Amazing stuff. Some of the other iOS 18 first-timers include RCS messaging support, being able to react to an iMessage with any emoji, and scheduling messages, all of them being a very welcome addition. Wait, we do have one more thing. Hair Track Pro. Leave a comment below if you would be interested in using this app, because I really need it. It would save a lot of time, as I would no longer need to remember where all my hairs are. I can just use the Hair Track Pro app for iPhone.
I mean, that's just good science, right?